the project that Madeline worked on with her team at SAS. We went through SpaceX and NanoRacks, and this girl up here has a little module that's similar to what these guys worked on. And these guys up here are some of Commander Williams' colleagues. So we send our payload up on a capsule to the space station, and we plug it into this power rack, and it has a USB port. Get data down every couple weeks, and then eventually the payload is returned for further study. I guess you guys are going to be looking at the DNA then. So we also do workshops. Like the guy here's got the CubeSat that I'm showing you right here. We have a workshop later today here. How many people are coming to that? A couple of you. Okay, cool. So there we will actually deconstruct one of these and have you put it back together, and layer by layer we explain each of the subsystems to you. And then you take some scripts and you run them to turn this on and then simulate a launch sequence on your computer. So we run these every other month or so. We have this one today, and we're going to have another one in a couple of weeks, and I'll give you details on that in a second. So the other really third thing that we've been doing that's really exciting is we run the NASA Space Apps Challenge. So this is a hackathon that NASA sponsors every year. We did it for the first time this year. And so in order to like really get you guys to understand how much talent and how much potential you have, let me just tell you, each country sends their best team to their global finals in Washington and for NASA, right? And they have six winners, and a Singaporean team won this year, one of the six categories. So it's a great story. There's two guys that are in NS, and then these two older people who have a little bit more coding experience. They were one of the six global winning teams with a project to monitor radiation. They came up with an app to do this. So that is actually the strength of the labor pool that we have here. And anybody who does anything in entrepreneurship, anybody who's thinking about it, you don't have to build your own rocket. You don't have to build your whole own space station to actually be able to engage in space entrepreneurship. There are many ways in which we can contribute. This is just a cool picture. This is the Dragon re-entering with our payload on it. Stars, and you can see the Earth's atmosphere right here. I have a copy of this picture I can give you if you want to see it. But let me just get back to what I was saying about entrepreneurship. The reason I have brought Commander Williams here is really to inspire Singaporeans to think of space tech and the whole commercial space industry, new space, as a viable path for them to move their careers forward. There are a number of ways in which you can do this. And you don't, as I was saying, you don't have to go and develop an entire spacecraft. There are subsystems, there's hardware, there's software that we already have here on Earth. If you think about IoT and the applications that we have here for smart cities, a lot of that can be translated into space. And if we are going to put people up in space anyway, everything we do on planet Earth will have to be done in outer space. So with that in mind, think about this. The Google Lunar X Prize, has anybody heard of the Lunar X Prize? It's a $30 million prize sponsored by Google, and they have a contest where you have to use private funding to get yourself to the moon, have a rover land on the moon, and travel 500 meters while returning HD TV. The deadline for this, the launches, is December 31st of this year. There were 16 teams globally. There was one from Malaysia that ended up not having the funding to go through, but four of the teams, the US, Israel, and then India and Japan, they actually have reservations on rockets to go up there. They're scheduled for the end of this year. And think about what a game changer that's going to be. And this is why I want you guys really to think about space as a viable option, because everybody's mentality, everybody's mindset when it comes to the access to space is going to change, because they're going to be sending live video back. So we have our phones. We're going to be able to watch on YouTube live video from the moon in a few months. And people don't believe it. They say it's crazy, but it's going to happen. One of these four teams will get there. And my thinking is, even if they don't make it in December 31st of this year, they will get there. And within the next year or so, we're going to just have a total game changer when it comes to commercial space. Right? And you know, just in general terms, if you tell people to develop something for space, they're a lot more inspired than if I say, go and invent something really cool, and then you can be a startup. That's one thing. But if I say, invent something that I can fly in space for you, that is a complete different way of approaching it, and that energizes people. That's what happened in the 1960s when we went to the moon, right? There were all these inventions that came out of that endeavor, that and we need to get back to that same level of just excitement. So, Lunar X Prize. Asteroid mining. If you know anything about the solar system, you know that asteroids are from the very early days of our solar system, and the minerals that they were formed with when they coalesced are still there, they're differentiated. So on Earth we have geological processes, and if you want to get gold or any other mineral out of a mine, you have to dig up some rock and then use chemicals or some other extraction process to get the minerals out. Now, on asteroids, there has been no geological processing. So you can figure out what the asteroid is made of, take some pieces of it, and bring it back. And so I say that some of these are worth trillions of dollars. That really is true, trillions with a T. We know how big these rocks are from the ground with telescopes. And we can study them using spectroscopy to look at their composition, and you can look up the current market value of any of these minerals, palladium, molybdenum, I always like to say that one, gold, carbon, anything you want to mine. You can mine everything on these asteroids. So you spend $100 million getting there, you get $1 trillion back, that's lots of extra zeros in your favor. So the government of Luxembourg is currently investing in a company called Deep Space Industries. So Luxembourg is about the same size as Singapore, right? They are investing $1.2 billion in this company to get asteroid mining going. So people are thinking about this. And then, of course, Elon Musk and Mars. He wants to go and colonize Mars. He's talking about getting there by 2030. And you know, everything from mining to human health will be required. And where you guys come in on all of this stuff, all of this is there is no way any of these entities is going to be able to get to where they want to go in space without help from the rest of the world. Elon Musk's factory in Southern California, he employs a couple thousand people. There's no way. And nobody has tapped into the talent in Asia yet in a sensible way. They bring the workers from here to the US, and with the current political climate, no comment, it's very difficult to get over there. As a matter of fact, one of our engineers was supposed to go to California to get trained on the International Space Station experiment, and they wouldn't give her a visa. We applied twice. And this was just a couple weeks ago. So, you know, if they're not gonna let us go there, let's just try doing it here. There's an enormous amount of math and science capability in this country. And I think my vision is that we can all really serve as an R&D hub here and do a lot of the manufacturing offshore, which you can do, you know, in a bunch of countries within just a couple hours flight, right? So this is really part of why I wanted to bring you guys here, to just let you know how real all of this stuff is. I'll try to change slides. Okay. So your future in space, I do think that we can become a global hub for space tech R&D. There are some companies here doing stuff in space already. And I can tell you more about these later on because I do want to get to Commander Williams. But Spire and Astroscale are bigger. They've gone through Series B or C, if you know anything about funding, and they have valuations between 40 and 70 million at the moment. Transcelestial is an optical communications company. They've just gotten their seed funding. Infinite Orbits is a company that's working with satellite motion. And Microspace is a company that does CubeSats for military applications. So we don't know a lot about what they do, but they are working here actively in Singapore. So then the three endeavors that we have, SG Cosmos is one of our companies that is taking the workshops that we run and scaling them up so we can provide more access. So if you stop by and see what we're doing later on today at 3 over in the back in the kitchen area, you'll see what we do here is face-to-face, and you have to physically be able to get here to when we actually have a workshop. We want to be able to scale up and provide larger access. So that company is handling the software for that. And then, of course, BSE does things like we do the workshops, we do the ISS project. I give talks all the time. Our team gives talks at Poly's, at Science Center, and so on. And then Astropreneurs Hub, Laptop to Launchpad. That is the entity that we want to have be the space tech incubator. And it's going to be a global incubator. We're already actively seeking out funding. We want people from all around this part of the world, certainly, and even globally, to come here and work with us. And we're not just doing like one of these typical like 3-month plans where you come, we teach you how to write a business model and give you some contacts and go away. Our goal is to actually get people onto the launch pad. So we will work with these startups so they don't have to reinvent the wheel getting frequency licenses, developing their tech, getting their hardware tested for radiation and vibration testing. We're going to work with them all the way through that, because I really want to see you guys putting your stuff onto spacecraft and getting it up there to get a space-qualified prototype. I think that's going to be a real game changer. So we've got the talks this week, the CubeSat workshop, and then we have a meetup group. If you're interested, come and see me. We meet every other month. We met at Google headquarters a couple of nights ago. Commander Williams spoke there. And we also had meetings all over the city. And UN World Space Week is another event that we're doing for the second time this year, Science Center. And again, we're going to do some more meetups and workshops for that. So with that, I would just want to say I'm very honored that Commander Williams has been here all week. We've put him through a lot. He has done, I don't even know how many events at this point, and he's been great. His talk is fantastic. I don't know if you want to do this in more of a casual way or if you want to, we've got some great movies, and I'm sure he wants to share his experience with you. 534 days in space, 5 spacewalks. He's been doing this for a long time, and he seems like he's just as comfortable up there as he is down here. So I'll give it to Commander Williams. Thanks.
Thank you, Babushi. Good to be here with you today. I think what I'm going to do is go through essentially my presentation. I think we have enough time. That's not the right thing. I think we have enough time, but I'm going to rush through it so that we get a little time left over for your questions, because I think that's always the most interesting part. So we're a little compressed on time, but that's okay. How many here have seen the space station fly over? Anybody? You haven't? Okay, that's your homework. Have you seen it? Where were you when you saw it? Here or somewhere else? Okay.
I registered myself on the NASA website.
Yes, there you go. Yeah, if you didn't know you can see it, you need to go see it. Go find, get an app out there or go to a website, look for ISS sightings, and you can go to either the website or the apps. I got a couple apps on my phone where I can track the station all the time, and it'll also give you predictions on when you can see it fly overhead. It's visible when it flies overhead, or not necessarily directly overhead, but anywhere in the view around you and your location on the Earth, when it's dark where you are, but the sun is still shining on the ISS, flying about 250 miles up off the Earth's surface. So right after sunset or right before sunrise would be the times you see it. You need to do that, especially when, after an introduction, if you follow along what's going on the ISS, you know who's up there, you get a little insight into what they're doing. It's very meaningful to watch it over. It's brighter than, watch them fly over, it's brighter than anything in the night sky with the exception of the moon, right? It's brighter than any star or planet out there. So you need to do that. This is the vantage point we're talking about. This sounds like the space station. People ask me what I miss the most when I'm up there, and of course some of the things are obvious, my family and friends and whatnot, but I also, I'm serious here, I miss quiet, because we have fans and pumps running continually in the background. You can't get away from it. Even when you do a spacewalk in the spacesuit, you got a ventilation fan and a pump running continually, so you can't get away from that noise. But we can endure this, right, for about 40 minutes. That's our vantage point. You recognize that to be our home, planet Earth. And the next slide is the platform that I'm talking about, the International Space Station. It's very large. A lot of people don't realize how big it is. If you could put it on the ground, it would cover a football field plus. If you could weigh it, it weighs almost 1 million pounds. Almost 1 million pounds of mass. Now, obviously, it was not easy to get up there. It went up there piece by piece, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a couple minutes. But that's the size of it. Right here in the center, there are the stack of cylinder-shaped modules. That's where the crew lives and works. That's the pressurized volume inside. If you added up all the volume that we live and work inside, it's about the volume of a 5,000-square-foot house. So it's very big even inside the station where we live and work. It typically has a crew of 6. We're rotating 3 at a time. I'm going to show you through, we're going to go through a video here in a couple minutes that'll give you sort of the rhythm of life on board the space station as we rotate 3 out of the 6 every couple of months. When you go to the space station, each individual stays about 6 months. That's the average time. I've been there 4 times. My first time was early in the assembly before Expedition 1 got there in 2000 on a space shuttle. And the next slide shows the space shuttle. Anybody here see a shuttle launch when it was flying? Anybody get to the Cape? Fortunate enough to do that. It was amazing to see a launch. 4.5 million pounds sitting on the launch pad. I'm sorry, 4 million pounds of thrust. sitting on the launch pad producing 7.5 million pounds of thrust. To get to orbit, about 40,000 pounds of payload. So a lot of energy, a lot of power to get up there, and in less than 9 minutes, you were in orbit. Just like any of the other rockets that go to low Earth orbit, the orbit that the space station is, you're in orbit in less than 9 minutes. And in that 9 minutes, you accelerate on the space shuttle about three times the force of gravity, and the Russian Soyuz about four times the force of gravity, to get to an orbital velocity of 17,500 miles an hour, or about 28,000 kilometers per hour, orbiting the Earth every 90 minutes or 16 times a day. That's what it takes to get there. That's driven by physics. You all know about physics. The space station has what I consider a near ideal orbit around the Earth for viewing and studying the Earth. The orbit, as I said, is about 250 miles up. It's inclined to the equator at 51.6 degrees. That means we cross the equator, go up to 51.6 north latitude, come back across the equator, go to 51.6 south latitude. And every time you come around, the Earth has rotated about 1,500 miles. You cross the equator about 1,500 miles to the west of the previous orbit. So over time, you see the entire globe, with the exception of the poles, in different lighting conditions, day, night, and different sun angles. So that lends itself to just be an ideal platform to view the Earth. Of course, it's an orbiting laboratory as well. And its primary purpose, I think the legacy of ISS will be primarily threefold. One will be the ISS achievement itself, putting this up there. And oh, by the way, we dedicated 37 space shuttle flights and about 40 Russian rocket launches just to get it built. We started building it in 1998, finished it in 2010. And now it's full up and running. And not only is it technically impressive, and you can only imagine the complexity of integrating all of those components, both hardware and software, components that were built in different parts of the world and not integrated and tested on the ground, but integrated on orbit. That in and of itself is pretty impressive. But the other aspect is that it was done in an international partnership, launching components from different places on the Earth and integrating them on orbit. And you can imagine that working in the partnership brings its own challenges, you know, its own challenges of diplomacy and whatnot. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. But that will be one aspect, I believe, of the great aspect of the legacy of the ISS. The other thing, aspect of its legacy, and it's growing now and continues, is its function as an orbiting laboratory, providing a very unique facility for science and research, experimentation across the different spectrums of science. And of course, that's ongoing, and I think that's probably the area that you would be most exposed to, and certainly you are using it, your team. Used it as a platform, as a facility to go do some unique research and get exposed to that entire process. So certainly that will be a part of its legacy. The third element, though, of its legacy, and I believe perhaps will be the most significant one, and hopefully I'm everywhere I go in the U.S., I advocate from a policy point of view that we need to even expand its use in this role, and that is technology development. It's a perfect platform to put a piece of technology up there and prove that it works, and it works as designed. And it that's in terms of both performance and reliability. And that technology development will be critical for future space explorations, whether we're going back to the moon or eventually, as we always hear, on to Mars. We need to improve the reliability, the performance, and the effectiveness, the efficiency of systems if we're going to be able to accomplish those goals one day. So technology development, in my view, is a key part of the ISS, and hopefully will be a big part of its legacy. What I want to do now is show you about a 15-minute video that chronicles my last flight, which occurred last year. I launched in March and returned in September of 2016. It was my fourth visit there. I mentioned my first. My second was about halfway through the assembly of the space station in 2006. That was 6 months long, and then I went back in 2009 and 10 for 6 months when we finished the assembly, and then last year had the opportunity to go back for another 6 months in the phase where it's fully operational. So this video is going to give you a sense for what I call the rhythm of life on the ISS right now as we rotate crews four times a year. This chronicles expeditions 47 and 48, which were the two expeditions I flew on last year. It is international. We do receive launch services now from the Russians on the Russian Soyuz. On my last three flights, we're on the Soyuz. Here you see the rocket rolling out to the launch pad about 2 days before liftoff. On launch morning, the crew gets into a launch and entry suits, and we take the ride out to the launch pad, do the final wave, ride the elevator to the top to strap in, to climb in and strap into the vehicle, the Soyuz spacecraft, which is at the top end of the vehicle. We get in about 2.5 hours before launch. We slither into this thing through the hatch, and three of us are in seats, in the capsule, in the fetal position, shoulder to shoulder. I call it as if we're triplets in the womb. And you feel that way too. If you're claustrophobic, you're in the wrong business. Yeah, that's a little stuffed animal. It's actually a toy for his daughter that he flew for his daughter, our Soyuz commander, Alexei Ovchinin. So we always have one of those things. That's the commander of the Soyuz usually hangs something up there, and it's usually a gift. We call it the zero G meter because it hangs on that string until we get the space and then it bounces everywhere. Even on the Soyuz, less than 9 minutes to get to orbit, as I mentioned, and then we're setting up for the rendezvous of the space station, which we, did you see it there? Okay. The space station, we get into view after a few hours, and that's what it looks like as we approach it. This is what we look like after we approach, get close to the station, line up with the docking port that we're going to dock with, and here's the final moments of docking to the space station with a couple of hours. We're opening the hatches, and we were welcomed on board by the crew of three who had already been up there for about 3 months. So we rounded out, along with them, what we call Expedition 47. At this point, we had three Russians, two Americans, and a British astronaut. So again, very international, and that was March of 2016. Here's what it's like coming through a couple of the modules in ISS. This right here is our dining room table, which we gather together. Try to get together as an entire crew at least a couple times a week and enjoy a meal, usually a Friday night. That was probably a Friday night. You can see it's very easy to move around the station. You just get yourself going in the direction you want. Easy to get around a corner and do the work there. A lot of fun, as you might imagine. It takes a lot of logistical support to support the operations on ISS. In our first 3 weeks we were there last year, we had three supply ships. That was a Russian Progress supply ship. Then we had an Orbital Sciences Cygnus supply ship show up a week later. Each of them carried between 5,000 and 6,000 pounds of supplies, equipment, food, water, clothing, etc., and experiments. A week later, we had a third one show up, SpaceX Dragon, also bringing close to 6,000 pounds of supplies and equipment. It also had a unique payload on board that we plucked out using the robotic arm and attached to the space station, and then inflated this module. It's called the BEAM module. BEAM is the acronym, standing for the Bigelow Experimental Activity Module. It's the first expandable module that we've had on the ISS. And that's a great example of what I talked about earlier, technology development. There's no plans to use it operationally, but we want to prove out the technology, the concept. So here you see in fast, sped up, very much sped up, believe me, it was a slow process of inflating this thing by allowing air into it from the space station. Very promising technology to volumetrically, efficiently launch habitable volume for either future free-flying spacecraft or habitats on the surface of, say, the Moon or Mars. So that was a major milestone that we celebrated as a crew, and so we took a crew photo in there. It's still flying. They plan on flying the beam module for the next several years at a minimum. That takes us into June of last year and marking the end of Expedition 47. Tim Coper, American astronaut who had commanded 47, handed over command to me, and that began Expedition 48. And it was the time for Tim and Yuri, who had been there when we arrived. They had completed their 6 months, so now it's time for them to prepare to go home. So we said goodbye to them. They got into their Soyuz spacecraft that they had arrived in 6 months earlier, got in their launch and entry suits, strapped into their seats, prepared for undocking, undocked, and returned to the planet. That left about 3 weeks where only three of us were on board. We stayed very busy for the 3 weeks doing the normal activities of running the space station, repairing it, having a little fun. And I like to say, during this time, when you're a crew of three, it's nice and quiet, relaxing. We're spread out in that huge facility. My Russian crewmates were usually busy at the other end, so I was by myself. It's sort of like when your extended family comes to visit you for the holidays and spends a week. It's a great day when they arrive and a great day when they leave. In the meantime, during that 3 weeks, there's another crew of three getting ready to launch from that same launch pad that we had launched from 3 months earlier in Baikonur Cosmodrome. They lifted off. In this case, they had a new model of a Soyuz. So instead of docking within 6 hours, they spent about 48 hours testing out the systems and then docking to the space station. After they got docked, of course, we did the pressure checks, got the hatches open, welcomed them on board. And they rounded out what we called Expedition 48. On this crew was an American astronaut, Kate Rubens, and Japanese astronaut, Takuya Onishi. The two of them, it was their first flight, which was one of my highlights, to be able to take a couple rookies and share all of the experiences, all of the elements that you go of the experience on the first flight. And they had a Russian cosmonaut, Soyuz commander as well. We do a lot of science and research on board. That's what most of the time is spent doing. Here's some shots of an experiment developed at MIT at Cambridge. It's called Spheres, and it's used to develop flight control systems for satellites. A very interesting hands-on experiment that we all enjoy to execute. And here I was doing it with my Russian crewmates. Here's another one, very interesting. These are human heart cells that Kate is looking at here under a microscope. These are live cells, and they beat in unison. So the cells communicate with one another and set up a beat in unison. Very interesting. I always thought our heart beat at the muscle fiber level, but it turns out they beat at the cellular level. Study of the human body in a weightless environment is a huge category of what we do. And here you see Alexei and I executing an experiment we call fluid shifts, trying to better understand the impacts on the human body in the weightless environment. This series of video clips here highlights the operation where we use this an airlock in the Japanese experimental module that allows us to put experiments and cargo outside. Not people, but experiments and cargo from inside to outside, using a robotic arm to pluck it out. And in this case, we were deploying some CubeSats. So some CubeSats, was mentioned earlier with the bacteria, we keep inside. Others we deploy from the space station, and they become free-flying satellites to perform whatever objective operations that are unique for that particular satellite. So now we get into mid-July. It's time for another cargo ship. This is another SpaceX Dragon. So we captured it with the robotic arm and then attached it, as we do every time, to the space station to get the hatches open and get all that 5,000 or 6,000 pounds of cargo out, along with some new experiments. This one also had a unique piece of hardware. You see here being plucked out with the robotic arm. We call it the International Docking Adapter. And it required us to go outside, Kate and I, to go outside to do two spacewalks to integrate it onto the space station, to connect it up to the very front end of the space station and get power and data to it and so forth. So that meant going outside for twice in 2 weeks. And we spend about 6.5 hours outside each time we go out. It is the most demanding thing that we do in the entire space flight, both physically and mentally. You can imagine being outside in a pressure suit. And the suit itself weighs about 350 pounds, so it's very massive. You are tethered 100% of the time for safety reasons, but all of the equipment and tools are also tethered 100% of the time. So it's a highly choreographed, detail-intensive activity while you're outside. It's also one of the most rewarding things that we do. And every once in a while, you get a break from the activities where you can actually just push away and hang out with one arm and look at the entire station, take it all in with the Earth in the background, which is absolutely incredible. I've had the opportunity in my career to go outside 5 times, and it definitely is a highlight. Spacewalks, I think we've done on the order of 205 or so, plus or minus, spacewalks in the life of the space station, to assemble it and then since then to maintain it. This place here in the station becomes a favorite place of most crew members in their free time. It's called the cupola. I call it the window on the world. It's sort of a hemisphere-shaped small module with 6 radio windows and a center window, and it's the one place you can go and see the entire globe of the Earth from a single vantage point. So it's a great place to be with a camera, and we've got professional quality Nikon cameras with all kinds of lenses, from fisheye all the way up to 800 millimeter lenses. And I spend a lot of time in my free time capturing the detail of the Earth, like this plankton bloom off the coast of South America. Here's a great horizon shot where you see the thinness of the atmosphere and the beautiful weather systems. Western North America with Central Valley right here, and the Sierra Nevada and the California coast in its typical cloud and fog formation. This is the most beautiful reef in the world, in my opinion, in the Bahamas. Just absolutely gorgeous, incredible. Doesn't look real here. These are ice flows off the coast of Canada early in the spring. Here's a riverbed with irrigation circles and the arid land around it in New Mexico. Southern tip of South America in the Patagonia region and the beautiful glaciers that are down there that come off 2 ice shelves in Chile. The Great Salt Desert in the eastern part of the country of Iran. Very unique geography, fascinating, and takes great pictures. Or right after a sunset, where you see the different layers of the atmosphere, and this is weather systems here silhouetting the sun, which is just back over the horizon. Just absolutely gorgeous, this hurricane or typhoon. The Alps, mountains in South Central Europe. And that's an oblique shot. Here's looking straight down with an 800 millimeter lens of the Grand Canyon and the Colorado River, or Grand Teton National Park in Wyoming and Jackson Hole. This is a very unique view of what we call noctilucent clouds, sometimes seen over the poles, either the North or South Pole. Very mysterious, not well understood. Those are just a few examples, like I mentioned earlier, that unique advantage point of the ISS being able to photograph the details of the Earth. Now we're into September of last year. It's time for Expedition 48 to come to a close. We've spent our nearly 6 months on board the ISS. So I handed over command to Anatoly.
Yeah. Really enjoyed the time we spent together at Expedition 48 on International Space Station.
And it transitioned the folks in blue to Expedition 49, and it was time for Alexei, Oleg, and I to say goodbye, clean up our stuff, get back into our Soyuz, get in the launch and entry suits, strap into those seats again, as if triplets in the womb, and then prepare for undocking from the ISS and to return home. The time from undocking to touchdown is about 3 hours and 15 or 20 minutes, so it happens very quickly. We prepare for undocking, undock, separate from the ISS to get a safe distance away, and then a couple of hours later, while flying backwards over the southern tip of South America, we fire the main engine a little over 4 minutes to now slow down enough so we'll re-enter into the atmosphere. The drag of the atmosphere, and here's a shot out the window, we're literally in a fireball, feeling about 4 times the force of gravity. That's what dissipates most of the the energy of orbital speed. After that phase of flight, the main parachute opens and we drift down for about 12 minutes, as I recall, to central Kazakhstan. In our case, the search and rescue forces had a visual contact of us as soon as the main parachute opened. So they were right there landing shortly after our touchdown and had us out of the capsule within 30 minutes or so. And then after some medical experiments and medical checks there at the landing site, we each got on a helicopter, flew about 2.5 hours back to the airfield they had staged out of. And then my Russian crewmates got on an airplane, went to Moscow. I got on another airplane here and took 3 legs to get back to Houston. And in about 24 hours after touching down in Kazakhstan, I was back home being reunited with family and friends. So that gives you sort of a sense, it personalizes it a little bit, of the rhythm of life on board the ISS. As this thing finishes up, I want to transition to Q&A, because I know you all have some questions. So who has the first question? First one's usually the hardest, but it's you're going to make it easy.
You must have been about the same age as my son when you saw astronauts first go into space. How was their experience when you talk to the old-timers? How is it different to yours?
Well, in some respects, it's the same, right? It's the same kind of thing. You anticipate going, and then you go, and you experience all those things. And then, among other things, you try to come back and describe and share the experiences, and they certainly went through that. I think one difference is it was a lot newer then. And of course, they were, because it was newer, although this is inherently a risky business, the risk that they were enduring, I would think, was significantly more than what we endure nowadays. The objectives were completely different, to go to the moon, and that was, of course, in the context of the Cold War and the geopolitical motivations that were behind that. Because of that, think about how quickly they had to advance in capability from first flight in the early 60s to landing on the moon 1969. Of course, they had a lot of funding to do it, but they were on the they were really pushing the technology development. Of course, on both sides, on the Russian side and the American side, we lost lives in that endeavor. And this is a very humbling work, I guess, to be in anyway for that reason. We've lost lives since then as well. I think another difference, of course, is they were subject to a little bit more of the public limelight than we are. You know, I can go most places and not be recognized. Those guys have got recognized everywhere, and there's a that prevents a, or presents a little limitation on life. So I prefer to be anonymous. That's why you don't normally see me running around in a flight suit. But so similarities and differences. Who has the next one? This one. The most interesting thing seen through the Earth, there's a lot of things. I mean, the list is endless in terms of variety, and that's a key, the variety of just fascinating things that you can see. On the short list, though, I would say the noctilucent clouds, and that shot that I have in that video, and I've taken many pictures of them, is the best shot that I know of. I mean, there was one day, during one day on one orbit, I got in the window just to check it out, and they appeared like I had never seen them before. And I had the camera ready, and the pictures turned out pretty well. And you just got a quick few seconds to look at it, right? I encourage you to look them up on the internet and go find some photography, high-resolution photography. It's just a fascinating phenomenon. Another very unique thing was in 2006 up there, flying over the Aleutian Islands. There were only two of us on board at the time, Pavel Vinogradov and I, so a crew of two. I was back having a bag of tea through a straw break with Pasha, and I got done with that. I was gonna head back to work. I passed by the window, saw we were flying over the Aleutian Islands. So I grabbed the camera just to take a picture of the Aleutian Islands off the coast of Alaska. And one of them didn't look right in the back of my mind, and I went back and reframed it, and it was a volcano erupting. And not only was it erupting, it was a brand new eruption because I had the entire plume in view. So that was another highlight, I guess, of the experience. But there are many, many more. I could talk for hours on that topic. Yes, sir.
Our weapon system deployed in space.
Are there weapon systems deployed in space?
Oh, I don't know, frankly. I am. I do have a military background, but I haven't been in that field at all. I know they're up there in the fiction world, you know, when you watch the movies. And we've heard about different kinds of developments related to space, but that's really all. I saw nothing. We are completely completely open program. Everything is open to the public. And contrary to what a lot of people think, we have no secrets. Of course, we protect technology, proprietary information, and whatnot in the space station program, but we don't have security secrets per se. Yes. What do I think of space movies? I got that question several times this week. I'll say this. Apollo 13 is my favorite space movie because they did a really good job of trying to make it realistic. They were true to the real story. There's certainly a little bit of special effects trying to recreate what it's like to be in a weightless environment, but they did a very good job of telling the story, the heroic story of really the not only the flight but the ground team who responded to that very critical accident of the blowing up of an oxygen tank, which took away the ability to accomplish the mission of landing on the moon. But without the ingenuity of that combined team, we would have lost that crew, and they safely got them back. And I know the story. I know the commander of that mission, Jim Lovell. He advised those folks when they produced the movie, and they did a very good job. Now, you get into some of the other movies, it can be a little bit entertainment, but there's a lot of license. People ask me when Gravity first came out, hey, what do you think of Gravity? And I kept saying, I don't know. I haven't seen it. And finally, on a flight on Singapore Airlines, by the way, between Houston and Moscow, when we used to have a direct flight, I watched it on one of those little screens just so I could see it. I'm glad I didn't waste my time going to the theater paying for a ticket. The Martian, they took some light. Yeah, that's the name of it, right?
The Martian.
Yeah, The Martian. It was actually a good movie. Of course, they take a lot of license in that. They violate the laws of physics and the laws of reality. In a way that Hollywood often does, but it's a good story. It was good entertainment. It gets us and the wider public thinking about the possibility of the dream of sending people to Mars. So it was good in that respect. I'll leave it all at that. That's it. How about one over here? Yes, sir. The question has to do with space debris. We worry about that, of course. Anything that's larger than, say, the breadth of my hand is tracked in terms of objects, debris from either rockets or satellites or spacecraft of different kinds. And the trajectory of those objects are predicted. They're easily predictable mathematically. So if one is predicted to come close to the ISS, we monitor, and at a certain point, we make a decision, and this is handled by the mission control centers, by the way, between Houston and Moscow, but we may maneuver the space station to separate that closest point of concurrence between the ISS and the object. The smaller objects, we can't do that because we can't track them. The very small objects, like a grain of sand or so, were largely protected by the design of the ISS with shielding on the outside. And there have been lots of places that the ISS has been impacted. You can see it if you do a spacewalk or look through some of the cameras. You can see where it's been impacted. There are quite a few little nicks on the windows, actually, which make you a little nervous when you first get up there and you look at a window and you see little nicks in the outer pane of glass. But it's designed to take those smaller hits. Worry's the wrong word, but we spend a lot of time preparing for the possibility, and there is a finite probability of being impacted in a way that would produce a depressurization of the ISS. So we've developed procedures and trained all the crews to respond in an emergency situation if we have a depress, with the priority, of course, to save the crew, and then second priority to save the station. So we have procedures that if we can locate where the leak is, we can isolate that part and save the rest of the station. Yes?
You guys are multinational, multicultural, and multi-religious, and there is only selection bias and law scientific. You haven't discussed the possibility of a job or
extra person. Let me try to rephrase the question. Since we're in a multicultural, multinational, multi-religious environment, do we have discussions on religion or God, possibility of God? Sure. That topic certainly comes up. Now, I would say that there's a very high level of respect for everybody's background and what everybody believes. So we don't get into discussions in terms of debating those things. So it depends, just like on Earth, it depends upon the individuals, right? Who's receptive to talk. Some people are very uncomfortable even talking those topics. There's a saying, I don't know, is it here? Never talk religion and politics. But that's because it can get you in trouble, maybe get somebody upset or whatnot. I find that's usually not the case. So if people are comfortable, I'm happy to talk about that stuff. So everybody has a different perspective. And we get into those discussions now and then. I get the questions like that more often in an audience like this than I do among us as a crew. But we are very much aware of each other's backgrounds, and we respect each other. Remember, our lives literally depend on each other. So we all work really hard to maintain a crew cohesion and a high level of trust with each other. If you ask about me personally, I'm a Christian, a practicing Christian with a pretty strong faith. So I view all of reality through through the lens of the Bible. So, the hand way in the back.
As a person who has spent the most time in space, do you find any challenges adapting in the weightless environment and then coming back to Earth? Because I understand there's some adaptation when you move between the space and on Earth.
Yeah, there's certainly an adaptation you go through. If you've been there multiple times, the adaptation is almost trivial. Last year when I got there, it was like getting on a bicycle again and just kind of picked up where I left off. In fact, the time before that had been 3 years since I had landed the previous time. And frankly, I had mixed feelings about going back. Not last year, but the one before in 2009. And I remember coming across the hatch, the open hatch, and thinking, oh, I'm here again. Seems like I never left. Another 6 months. But that's just one of those psychological things you go through. If you're going there for the first time, it takes a while to adapt. Some people get ill, like a motion sickness, not everybody. But I would say that everybody goes through an adaptation of some type over about 6 weeks. So it's pretty significant. I think we're out of time here. Again, the time was short.
One more question.
Okay. All right, one more question. This is the final one. Yes.
Do you guys have like specific specializations because you have like engineering experiments, like
we're all trained to be generalists, so with the exception of maybe spacewalks, which almost everybody is trained for them, but not everybody. Other than that, we're trained to do anything and everything. So we may be assigned to do anything, whether it be experiment, or maintaining the space station or other things. So we're pretty well generalist. And the backgrounds include engineering. Probably half the folks have an engineering background. A lot of folks have science backgrounds of different types. Medical doctors in the ranks. And there's even a couple of educators, which were hired back in the early 2000s with an emphasis on education, STEM promotion, and that kind of thing. I don't know if we should we end here, I guess, because you have something starting up right now.
So I did want to ask you one question, because we are talking about innovation and we're in a startup space. In all the time that you've been up there, if there were one technology that you wish you had that you didn't have, what would that be?
Any Star Trek fans here? That one technology would be beam me home for the weekend, Scotty. Right,
thanks. So you do have another video that we might want to run at the end. Do you want to narrate that?
Okay, this is a 3-minute video, so I'm going to go 8 minutes over my time, or what is it? Spectacular video that gives a great gives you a great view of what it's like to view the Earth from that vantage point. This is Aurora, and you'll see scenes from both Aurora in the south and the north. That's the structure of the space station up there in view. And here we're crossing from Europe into the Middle East. And those are city lights at nighttime. Look at the atmosphere, the thin layer of the atmosphere relative to the Earth. Also, notice the star field in the background. This is a solar ray, which it rotates continually to track the sun. Lightning, massive thunderstorms. Look at the Milky Way in the background there. And we have some more city lights crossing the United States. Right here, Chicago. There's Lake Michigan, Detroit, the rest of the Great Lakes. Crossing the United States again from west to east into the Midwest, Rocky Mountains and into the plains. More city lights now in Europe. Here's London, and over into France and Germany, Denmark. A moon set. Looking across Canada. Center, watch what rises above. A comet. There's London and Paris. Pretty amazing, no? Thank you.
Can somebody get the lights? All right. So So thank you everybody for coming. I wanted to thank ASTRATPL and also Coding Girls for supporting us through this. And we've also been sponsored by a security company, Concord Security, and BSC and Entrepreneurs Hub. I wanted to thank Commander Williams for making a huge difference in terms of our approach to space and opening up literally the universe to us when it comes to innovation here in Singapore. If you've been to any of his events other than this, you've seen we're always standing room only. And I think you've done so much to change our mindset when it comes to space and space exploration. So cannot thank you enough. Thank you so much to you and your wife. So he is available for a few minutes to get a couple pictures. And then we do have a few signed lithographs to give away, but let's just form an orderly line, please. He's been swamped all week, so if we can just kind of line up around here. And those of you who are here for the workshop, we're going to be setting up in the back to work on the satellites over by the lunch area. So I'll see you guys over there.